Nation, hope you have a fantastic Thursday. And if you are wondering why you are getting this extra video because you missed the other two extra videos this week where I explained it. This week, in addition to a brand new Philip DeFranco show every Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, I've been testing with some morning videos covering topics I want to include in the show, but I'm worried that by including it, YouTube will slap down my entire video. But the positive side effect for you guys is that you've been getting more videos and more news coverage. But with that said, I want to talk to you today about two incredibly troubling stories that I feel we should talk about. And the first thing we're going to talk about is the story coming out of Colorado around Christopher and Shenan Watts. And where this story begins is Monday, August 13th. And on that day at around 1:40 p.m., we have an officer responding to a call to check on the well-being of someone. And that person being Shenan Watts. This because her friend Nicole was concerned because she wasn't able to get in touch with her that day. That morning at around 1:48 a.m., Nicole had dropped Shenan off at her house after a business trip where she lived with her husband, Chris, and their two children, Bella and Celeste. And this is in Frederick, Colorado, which is about 30 miles north of Denver. Shenan, who was reportedly around 15 weeks pregnant at this time, according to Nicole, also missed a doctor's appointment that morning at 10 a.m. She was reportedly supposed to go in to hear her unborn child's heartbeat, and Nicole was just concerned in general because Shenan wasn't really feeling good during their trip. Also, we learned that before going to police, Nicole went to Chris and Shenan's house and tried to enter, but she couldn't, though she did say she saw Shenan's car in the garage. So then she called Chris, asking him to come because she thought maybe Shenan might be hurt or passed out. And so it's after that the officer responds. He tries to enter the house, but found everything locked. He also called Chris, who arrived a few minutes later, and they all go inside to look for Shenan and the two children. Unfortunately, they don't find anybody. And so the officer begins asking Chris questions about when he last saw her, what had happened. According to Chris, who worked as an operator at Anadarko Petroleum, a large oil company in the area, he had gotten up early at around 5 a.m. for work. Chris then saying he had a conversation with his wife, telling the officer that he expressed to his wife that he wanted to separate, adding that they weren't arguing, but they were emotional. And after they had that back and forth, he said his wife said she was going to take the children to a friend's house that day, but he couldn't remember the friend's name. And he said at around 5:30 a.m., preparing to go to work, he backed the truck into the garage to load some tools, and he left for work. And during that time, he said his wife was still in bed when he left. And a neighbor surveillance camera also seemed to corroborate that story. You see Chris back into the driveway. He departs at 5:30. And after hearing this story, the responding officer asked for a detective to assist. And a thing to keep in mind at this time is that Chris is allowing the officer and the detective to look around. And that detective arrives, starts looking around, finding Shenan's personal items like cell phones, purse, wallet, medication, her shoes near the front door. When they found her phone, Chris allowed the detective to look through it. The detective also found their bedding stripped from their bed, lying on the floor, but found no evidence of anything suspect. That night, the police conduct a neighborhood canvas to see if they can find Shenan and the two girls. But unfortunately, all three were still missing. The next day at 7 o'clock in the morning, they still had not returned to the house. And at that point, the detective requests a press release be issued and assistance from the Colorado Bureau of Investigation and the FBI. The CBI then releases a tweet with the mother and the two children's names and faces that day. This story picks up a ton of steam. And on August 14th, Denver 7, a local station, they interview Chris Watts. And in that interview, we see that he pled for his wife and children's safe return.
Shenan, Bella, Celeste, if you're out there, just come back. Like, if somebody has her, just please bring her back. I need to see everybody. I need to see everybody again. This house is not complete without anybody here.
But the very next day, things change. And we've learned a lot about this story this week thanks to an affidavit that was unsealed on Monday. Investigators believe they actually knew where Shenan, Bella, and Celeste were. Using a drone over the oil and gas site owned by the company where Chris worked, they ended up spotting a bed sheet that matched the pattern of some of the family pillowcases and a top sheet from Watts' home. And along with that, they saw fresh movement of dirt consistent with a clandestine grave near the oil tanks. And in addition to that, police also found out that Watts was having an affair with a coworker. In the evening they found out about all of this, Chris told investigators he would tell everyone the truth after he spoke with his dad. And this time, Chris gave a new timeline of events. Although he originally said that he left that morning after talking about separation once, he said he actually returned to the bedroom to talk to Shenan again. But he says when he got back, he saw his wife on the baby monitor video feed strangling Celeste, the youngest child, and that Bella was already blue and sprawled out on her bed. And he says that sent him into a rage and he strangled his wife to death. After which, he said he loaded the three bodies into the backseat of his truck and he went to an oil work site to dispose of the bodies. And he ended up burying Shenan near two oil tanks and dumped his children's bodies in oil tanks. And what ended up happening was Chris was arrested on suspicion of 3 first-degree murder charges and 3 charges of tampering with a deceased body. Bodies that police found where Chris said they would be. And afterwards, we know that autopsies have been conducted, but the results have not been released at this point. And actually, on that note, the defense attorney for Chris filed a motion to take DNA swabs of the children's throats, but the judge denied the motion, saying, "This court cannot order the prosecution and or coroner how to conduct their investigation." But we'll see what happens there, because the general idea behind this seems to be to establish whether Chris's timeline of events has any merit, especially regarding his claim that his wife was strangling the children. Also this week, we learned that Chris has now been charged with 9 felonies. 3 counts of first-degree murder, 2 counts of first-degree murder for causing the death of someone under the age of 12 while being in a position of trust, 1 count of unlawful termination of a pregnancy, and 3 counts of tampering with a deceased body. And now, because Chris is facing these charges in Colorado, he faces up to life in prison or the death penalty. But as of right now, prosecutors have declined to say whether they would seek the death penalty or not, and they have 63 days after the arraignment to decide. And as far as where Chris is now, he has not entered a plea and he has been denied bond. And that is where we are with this situation right now. The next time we will see Christopher Watts is in court for a status conference on November 19th. And as far as my personal takeaway from this story, with what we have right now, it's hard for me not to imagine that Christopher Watts is 100% guilty. I mean, we know without a doubt he murdered his wife. He has admitted to at least that. But the rest immediately gets called into question since he initially lied to police and he disposed of 3 bodies. Not really the actions of a person I would personally think to be innocent. And for me personally, it's just impossible to block out of my mind the raw video footage that has been released of him just lying to the news and misleading the public. He's just lying through his teeth, seemingly feigning emotions, all the while he knows where they are because he dumped the bodies. The whole story just breaks my heart and it leaves me furious. But with that said, I'll pass the question off to you here. What are your thoughts around this? At this point, do you think that anything he says can be believed? Do you think that his story holds water? I'm really interested to see any and all of your thoughts here. And unfortunately, that's not the last bit of bad news in this video. And that's because we need to talk about 20-year-old Molly Tibbetts. Last month, on July 18th, Molly, who was a 20-year-old student of psychology at the University of Iowa, disappeared. At the time, she was reportedly dog-sitting at her boyfriend's home in Brooklyn, Iowa. And it's a pretty rural town with around 1,400 people. She was off school for summer break and was working at a local daycare. But the following morning, she didn't respond to her boyfriend Dalton Jack's good morning text message. Additionally, her workplace couldn't get a hold of her after calling, found that their phone calls went straight to voicemail, and soon after, family reported her missing. And while authorities weren't sure whether she had gone missing on the evening of July 18th or the next day, at first, eventually investigators pinned down that she was last seen going on a jog at around 7:30 p.m. near where she was dog-sitting. And what followed was a massive search effort. We saw investigators canvassing pig farms, cornfields, nearby properties. They tried to use data from her Fitbit and cell phone, as well as looking through her social media to find any clue about her whereabouts. A Facebook page was started to help find her. A reward fund from Crime Stoppers of Iowa was started with initially only $2,000 for information leading to her whereabouts. And it eventually garnered more than $385,000 by the end of the investigation with over 200 donors. We even saw the Iowa government start a website called Finding Molly to help locate her. And her family and boyfriend canvassed at the Iowa State Fair to help locate her in early August.
The importance of keeping Molly's story public so that we can keep driving information and tips to the authorities.
We're very hopeful that she's still alive and that she's gonna come back safe.
By the end of the investigation, the special agent in charge of the Iowa Division of Criminal Investigation, Richard Ron, and he said there were more than 4,000 tips received, that investigators spoke to hundreds of people to follow up on leads. And after all of that, law enforcement announced a massive update to the case this week. Investigators releasing new information about the Tibbetts case.
A first degree murder charge was filed today in connection with the disappearance of Molly Tibbetts, who was last seen jogging in Brooklyn, Iowa on July 18, 2018. A complaint and affidavit names Christian Bahina Rivera, age 24, who resides in rural Poweshiek County, and he has been charged with murder in the first degree. Dozens of law enforcement officials from local, state, and federal agencies were involved in the investigation after the disappearance of Molly Tibbetts. A body was discovered early this morning in a farm field southeast of Brooklyn, Iowa. The identity has not been confirmed, however, we believe it to be the body of Molly Tibbetts.
And at the press conference, investigators said that a week or two ago, they received a massive break in the case.
Well, during the investigation, we reached out to the public, as you well know. And during our neighborhood canvas, we came across an individual that had security cameras. We took those cameras. He was kind enough to give us the footage from it. And through that, we were able to identify a vehicle that we believe belonged to Mr. Rivera. It was a black Malibu. And from that, we were able to track his pattern and the routes in which he took. We were also able to find Molly running on this video, and we were able to determine that he was one of the last ones to have seen Molly running, based on the video, again, that we were able to seize from the general public.
And while they had gotten a hold of the footage a week or two ago, they only ended up approaching Rivera this past Monday, and they said that he was compliant, saying that he readily answered their questions and explained what happened.
And during that interview, he tells us that he sees Molly running and was able to come upon her, approach her, and while he was interfacing with her, he actually tells us that he ran alongside of her or behind her. And then at one point, he tells us that Molly grabbed a hold of her phone and said, "You need to leave me alone. I'm going to call the police." And then she took off running. He in turn chased her down. And then he tells us that at some point in time, he blacks out.
And after she threatened to call the police, Rivera said that his memory began again with him seeing headphones on his lap. And at that point, he said that he realized that Tibbetts was in his trunk. He found her there with blood on her head, and he then dragged her several yards into a cornfield where he left her with corn stalks covering her. And after the questioning, Rivera led investigators to where the body was. And so that's why at this press conference, law enforcement said he has been charged with first-degree murder, and he faces the penalty of life in prison without the possibility of parole. He was initially held on $1 million bond, but prosecutors requested that it be raised to $5 million, and it was granted. And as far as if there was any motive, they said that for whatever reason, he was just drawn to her that day. And one of the standout angles we've seen from this story is that according to law enforcement, Rivera is an undocumented person who has lived in the area for around 4 to 7 years. The Department of Homeland Security confirmed to local officials that Rivera was undocumented. After the arrest, a representative for ICE said that they filed an immigration detainer on Rivera. However, according to an AP reporter, despite being undocumented, Rivera had passed the government E-Verify system to work at a nearby farm. And that E-Verify system is a government program that allows employers to confirm the eligibility of employees to work in the states. It includes comparing records against Social Security and DHS records. And interestingly enough, the farm that he worked at, which is called Yerbie Farms, it's run by Eric Lang and owned by the family of Craig Lang, an Iowa farmer and GOP candidate. And they confirmed that Rivera had been employed there for the last 4 years. The main point here, the fact that Rivera was in the country illegally has become a very political issue. We saw Vice President Pence tweeting, "Heartbroken by the news about Molly Tibbetts," adding, "We commend the swift action by local, state, and federal investigators working in Iowa in apprehending an illegal immigrant who's now charged with first-degree murder." And we also saw President Trump speaking on this issue in West Virginia at a campaign rally.
"You heard about today with the illegal alien coming in very sadly from Mexico, and you saw what happened to that incredible, beautiful young woman. Should have never happened illegally in our country. We've had a huge impact, but the laws are so bad. The immigration laws are such a disgrace. We're getting him changed, but we have to get more Republicans."
And actually, new information has come out about his past employment and Rivera's immigration status. According to his former employer, he provided an out-of-state ID card and social security number. Also correcting a statement previously made by the company, Dane Lang of Yerbie Farms actually said they did not use the federal E-Verify system to confirm Rivera's identity. Instead, he said they used an employment verification system that came back okay. Rivera's attorney also said that Rivera did have the documents to work legally in the United States, but it appears the attorney may be basing those claims on previous statements of Yerbie Farms saying they had verified Rivera's immigration status. And for now, that is where we are with this story. We have President Trump and others using this as a reason why you need to vote Republican, why the United States needs to change immigration laws. But on the other side, you have people arguing that the president and others are just politicizing this situation, that they're villainizing and taking the violent outliers of a large group to paint the entire group, arguing that immigrants, illegal or not, do not commit violent crimes at a different rate than your everyday American. And if we are looking at this from kind of an analytical, political situation, it does make sense that the Republicans are arguing this point. There's a lot happening right now going into the 2018 midterms, but the issue that matters the most to most right-leaning voters is immigration. But also, that is my personal takeaway with the situation, and I want to pass a question off to you. What are your thoughts on this story? Or, I mean, this is the end of the video. What are your thoughts on the first one? Anything that really stuck out to you, I'd love to know your thoughts in those comments down below. But that is where I'm going to end today's show. It does not feel appropriate to do the regular outro regarding social stuff. So I just want to say thank you for watching this Extra Morning News video. I love your face, and I will see you today on today's Philip DeFranco Show.